Album Concept Hour. The Album Concept Hour. It's the Album Concept Hour.
Welcome, everybody, to the Album Concept Hour. I am your host, Brad LeBaron, as I always am. And I am here joined by my co-hosts, Dave and John. How's it going, Dave and John?
What's going on? Pretty good, man.
You know, ready to hear to talk about some Elton John.
Oh, yeah, Elton John. Yeah, we have Elton John, Goodbye Yellow Brick Road today. You know, nothing too special about today's episode. You know, just another one in the books, you know what I'm saying? And hold on.
I think there's something very special.
Oh, is there? Hold on. Wait. Do you guys hear that?
No.
Well, you don't hear
that? No,
I do. Oh, my God.
Oh. I do know.
Hey, guys. Oh, hold on. I think we do have a guest today. Yeah, that's right. That's right. Ron Wasserman's coming back to the podcast. Oh, my God. Ron Wasserman, how's it going?
Welcome, good.
Welcome back to
doing?
The Album Concept Hour.
I
heard this audience, and I just... You know, I look back at my notes and I was like, oh, yeah, that's right. We do have a guy coming in. So, Ron Wasserman, how's it going, man?
How are you guys doing? Everything's good.
Virtual land.
Yeah, doing good. Glad to see you again on the podcast. It's been a little while. Some cool stuff has happened over in Ron Wasserman land. We're excited to have you back. He is the composer of the Power Rangers theme, as well as many others. Again, thank you for coming on.
My pleasure.
Yeah, before we get into Elton John, I know we talked about Elton John at the front of this, but like, we have to ask you about the current goings on of the Power Rangers. Me and John in particular have an interest in this.
Dave was watching a certain special.
Probably going to be a little confused about some of
I'll
of
let you guys
this,
take
but,
this.
You
guys grab the wheels.
If you're between the ages of 30 and 35, something very exciting has happened for a very important series from our childhood, and that is the 30th anniversary of the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. And Ron, I understand that
I saw your name on
the
screen.
I almost leapt out of my chair. You are
me too.
You are back on the roster. Tell us about this,
Netflix.
Ron.
Oh, it was awesome. So they contacted me, the director contacted me last July and asked if I wanted to score the special coming that they were working on.
Wow.
And I said, absolutely, I'm in. I'll do it.
Yeah, yeah.
Said, we'd love to have you. And then they thought they'd be done around August, but things got delayed and I got it in December and spent 5 weeks on it. I took off Christmas Eve and New Year's Eve, but I worked from December 6th or 7th until a little bit later in January. It was great. I loved working on this thing because it was so different.
What was like different between your first experience creating, you know, back in the original series and then this one, like 30 years later, like
Bond versus Hasbro Netflix, I guess, right?
Yeah, exactly. Well, you know, they shot everything instead of using Japanese footage. That's a big plus.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
The first one was a lot sillier, you know, the original series, and was fine. There was a lot of comic relief in it. This didn't have any of that. I mean, I cannot imagine like a drone shot back in the old series and then somebody getting killed.
Talk about death.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. Right. Yeah, yeah. There's a lot more stabs than I remember in Power Rangers. Yeah.
Yeah. So it was like scoring a whole entirely new project. And of course, you know, the technology I have is off the charts now. So anything I wanted to do, anything I was looking for was really, really simple. I mean, I could pull up any sound. So whatever was in my head was really easy to do. I had a great time.
Yeah. Yeah. How many,
soundtrack was great, by the way.
I was going to say, how many tracks was it that you ended up composing for this project?
Like, they're thinking of releasing a soundtrack album.
Ooh,
and there's 34 tracks. I cut it down to 34.
You cut it down to 34. Okay.
It's a lot. It's like 40, I can't remember, maybe 47, 48 minutes of music, maybe 50.
Okay.
It's a lot.
Okay. Wow. Okay. And it's just like shorter, just right to it kind of tracks. that fills it up.
Yeah, there really wasn't there wasn't a lot of just dialogue in this thing. Originally we thought there would be, but then it was better to fill it up more. So it's not wall to wall, but it's almost wall to wall, which is fine with me. And I know it's done very well at Netflix. I read yesterday that it's been watched a total of some absurd amount, like 65 million hours.
I've watched it two or three times myself.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm going to be watching this once or two more times. I watched it today. And
great rewatch.
Man, there's not a lot of series that I get emotional about, and just literally seeing them on the screen together, the old, like, you know, Black and Blue Ranger on the screen together, I was like, oh man, like, I'm just thinking about like what all these people have went through over the past while, and like
past 30 years.
Yeah, past 30 years, like, just, you know, what they, you know, I know that I've seen, you know, Zach, the Black Ranger on a lot of social media stuff, and he's, you know, been making rounds, but like Billy, Billy's got the tragic backstory. Of course, in his personal life.
But I was going to say too, though, like both of them were on that Netflix special.
Yeah,
though,
no,
like
and they were just
the toys that made us.
Oh yeah, they're both on that too. That's right. Great. So they must be like friends in real life. I'm guessing those two hang out or something.
When Billy says, "Come get these hands,"
yeah, I do love the like. It's, I mean, visually and with the editing, it's such a perfect callback to the original series. Like, I mean, you know, even if you want to say some of the CGI, maybe like isn't as like crisp as like, you know, a Marvel film or something. But what I liked about all of that is that it fit with the, you know, the spirit of what it originally was.
And the CGI, some people were complaining about it. I didn't answer any of those, but I was thinking, you know, that's the difference. I don't know what the budget was on this, but that's the difference between people busting their ass, probably with a fair budget, and Marvel, where they're spending $200 million. So,
yeah,
I mean,
yeah, exactly. It's not fair.
And taking 2 years. Yeah. You can't compare.
Yeah. Yeah. And plus with Power Rangers, especially, I mean, I don't like the special effects were, you know, fun and exciting and everything, but I don't think it was like we were ever as fans of the show, like looking for like realism, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like it's a fantasy adventure thing. And people, you know, sometimes need to,
I think if you match the feeling of like the original series, that season, that first one, the fans are going to appreciate that. They're not looking for $10 million, like the crazy, like this over the budget. Like they just want, like,
we wanted them. Our high yas, and they gave them.
They gave us all the high yas. They gave us
us the dance keto again.
Yes, they did.
Alpha, you got Alpha coming back. You know, like it's just
Rita with the face.
I didn't mind.
That's my biggest complaint.
But you do at least see Rita. You see the OG Rita in the shots.
I just don't understand.
Tell us what you guys think about the face. Anyways, Rita Repulsa, if you are between the ages of 30 and 35 and you listen to this podcast, tell us what you thought of the Power Rangers special in general. Seriously, it was I had a great time watching it, and the particular, I think maybe my favorite song that I was hearing was in the fight in the juice bar, where the Red Ranger and the Black Ranger are kicking putties, and it's real funky and smooth. So
And then switching it over to the little bit of rap dance groove thing was easy feat, believe me.
That was
not easy. How am I gonna get from orchestral and rock to this? Okay.
Yeah.
I would also like to compliment you on I noticed your little bulk and skull bit you did when they hit the sign.
That
was very good timing.
Yeah, the
very
little
good
sting.
Nice placement. I noticed it right away.
Yeah.
2 seconds.
But fun. iconic though for again people between the ages of 30 and 35. I was trying to do the math earlier, like what is the age range for the biggest Power Ranger fans. I think I mostly have it, but let me know if you're outside of that range and you're still a huge fan. I mean, there's of course the senpai you know, fans that have been fans for a long time before all of that and everything, but Yeah. It's just good to see this legacy celebrating, especially after, you know, the tragedy of losing Tommy. Sorry,
rest in
not
peace.
His that's not his real name, Jason Frank.
Right? I still wish they would have been in the special.
Well, I mean, you know, they could have done like a Ghostbusters thing where they, you know, did a weird CGI thing, but I'm totally glad that they didn't attempt.
It worked.
Yeah, I have no idea why he wasn't in it. I guess there's just some, who knows? Maybe he said no. We'll never know.
Yeah, and it's okay that if they want to, you know, keep that behind the scenes, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Especially considering what happened, you know. Again,
it was great work.
Yeah, it was great work. We had to talk about that before we get into the Elton John. Today we're covering Goodbye Yellow Brick Road. And this is the album that you chose from our list. So why was this the one that jumped out at you for breaking down the tracks?
Well, Elton John was probably the biggest influence when I was growing up as far as playing rhythmic piano stuff.
Oh,
so I learned a majority of everything he did.
Oh, wow.
And just to kind of get that feel. And it, in some ways, it shaped that kind of left hand, right hand rhythmic playing that then turned into guitar sounds that then turned into, you know, Power Rangers, for example.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. It's just that kind of, because that's the way he would play a piano part. And I just always just admired his work. And Bernie Taupin's lyrics are just genius.
Yeah.
Incredible.
Yeah. Yeah. They're fun. I really, really enjoy reading them and hearing them and figuring out the little things that he's sprinkling all over the place, you know?
Yeah. I mean, there is some stuff in these lyrics that, you know, I didn't know for years and years and finally looked it up. I'm like, oh, that's what he was saying.
Yeah. Now that we have like Genius and stuff, we can like look at all these like, oh, this is what he said in an interview in 1982 about the song. It's like, oh, wow. Interesting. I have a lot of a really packed notebook of notes here because it's a double album that we're covering today, but we're covering it all in one go because it's only 17 tracks, so I think we can, you know, the way things we do things, we should be able to pull it off. Goodbye Yellow Brick Road, though, what is about this album in particular about Elton John you love?
I think this had, because it's not a thematic album by far, and there's definitely a few songs on there that I never loved, but a majority of them, it's just fantastic songwriting.
Yeah.
And he just created a ton of hits off this thing. I mean, it's just amazing.
Yeah.
And I like the vibe of it. I was also, you know, when he did Brown Dirt Cowboys, that album, I think that's the name of it.
Yeah.
That was really fantastic. Cool, but it was pretty country for me, for my taste back then.
Okay,
but it was cool.
Well, you know, it was
beautiful.
Yeah.
But this album is such a classic, and that's why. It was just instantly brilliant.
Well, yeah, I mean, the first four tracks are just all amazing tracks. Like, I don't know, there's not a whole lot of albums that have such a front loaded, set like this, you know, like Funeral for a Friend, Love Lies Bleeding is actually two songs that they turned into one. He starts the album with was it 11 minutes, something like that.
It's very long. The wind's blowing, the chime, the church bell is going, and then he comes in with that that now by today's standard cheesy little synth sound, but it's so cool. And it's amazing to think that he played all that stuff. Nothing's sequenced. I mean, everything is just being actually played. So it's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Like that's the thing. Like sometimes people forget the technology and the context of when something was recorded. You know what I mean? And they're like, oh, synth, blah.
Because they're thinking like today's mindset, like, oh, well, this was easy. Like, why was this so? Like, no, it's
It's like, no, it was.
To make this, like, what, 50 years ago now?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, God, has it really been? When did it come out? That I didn't look up.
50, like, literally.
74, I think?
It's 73, so it's literally 50 years. Oh,
Jesus Christ.
God. Yeah, yeah. I didn't even realize that while looking up this stuff.
To actually do that then is very impressive.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
So all the times you have to, like, be in that mindset, like in that mind, like when it was made, like, no, this is very impressive for what they're doing and what they had to work with. So, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You guys want to hear a little bit of that first track? This is A Funeral for a Friend and Love Lies Bleeding. I forgot what exactly I got. Oh, yeah.
Right. Yeah, you're right at where it's coming out of Funeral into Love. Uh-huh.
It's big and bold and grandiose.
So many good parts in that song too, and that was hard to pick a clip for, but I was like, I think I have to choose that
middle ground.
Yeah that little
spot.
Well,
we agreed that we wanted to, like, capture the band as well as Elton John. He was with that band for like 5 or 6 years. They toured with him, they did most of the recording with him,
some significant years too.
Big albums,
definitely
some jams.
Yeah, I was backstage at one of his concerts like a long time ago. I can't remember how. I think I knew his publicist, and so I met Bernie and I met a couple other members of the band, and then they asked if I wanted to meet Elton John, and I said no, because he was such an idol to me that if he didn't look me in the eye or blew me off, I would have been devastated. So I said, no, I'm gonna pass on that. But I hung out with Bernie for a bit. He was just so chill. I mean,
man.
I said, my God, your lyrics are amazing. He's like, thank you. And then starts, you know, like, really just the nicest guy.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's a really cool move, though. Cool. Actually, no. Really, like, cool. I'd rather just keep it the way it is. You
In
know?
My head.
Yeah.
There's... You know, I've experienced that only once. That's with the band Me Without You. I used to be obsessed with. Like, I saw the dude, like, I could have met him many times, and I was like, no.
Yeah.
Sometimes that's the way it has to be.
I've heard too many horror stories, so no.
Yeah. But oh man, that must have been amazing. Did you ask him, like, did you get any, like, insight into any specific lyrics, or did you just leave it at, like, I love your lyrics?
Appreciation.
I just appreciate him because once you start digging, they're like, I talk about this 16 hours a day.
That's true.
I didn't want
Here's
that.
My book. Let's just take my book, actually, and that'll cover everything.
We're backstage at the forum. Figure it out.
Oh man, but that would be so wild being in just the presence of such legends of rock and roll. You know, I mean, that's just what year was that you
geez, that must have been like around 2000.
That's
when all of a sudden, you know, I was signed to Universal, so I knew people, so I'd end up backstage walking around at the Stones tours, and
okay.
That was fun.
Yeah, absolutely. Sounds like a great time. That's what you do, man. Yeah, I would kill for that. This the first track, though, getting to a few of the themes, the funeral thing, I guess, is like, apparently what kind of music Elton John wanted at his funeral. And it's funny because it's called Funeral for a Friend. The friend being himself, or I guess it's Taupe from Taupin's perspective. So never mind.
Well, now he has his song.
Yeah, exactly.
And I know on some of this stuff, I can't remember this album, but a friend was telling me they're going back to the original tracks and mixing it in Dolby Atmos. So that's pretty freaking amazing. It'll be fun to hear that.
Yeah. I don't even know. Like, I don't even fully understand what that sounds like yet, because I don't have, like, equipment for it, you know.
It's I haven't been in an Atmos. It's like when you go to a film. they're all Dolby Atmos now. Just it's right, just right. surrounds, and you can create amazing panning and depth.
Yeah, yeah.
And so yeah. I have a friend that up in Oregon that hopefully he'll be able to play me some of that.
Yeah.
When that's done, that would be great.
That yeah, yeah, that'd be amazing. Wow. This next track we got for you guys though is another real classic. I know we, you know, we're talking about a lot of bangers in this album. We have a lot of hits. The first track, by the way, Love Is Bleeding, was covered by Weird Al Yankovic in his ill-advised blah 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 vanity tour. One of the songs he performed, and it's on the Wikipedia page for this song. You know, just before we move along, I had to point that out. I had to drop that in there. It's also a live favorite. But yeah, really, really great track. And then we get on to, I think, one of his most well-known songs in general, Candle in the Wind.
Yeah, it was a huge hit. Oh,
sorry.
Oh. Never knowing who to cling to when the rain set in. Yeah, that track is how I learned that Marilyn Monroe's name was Norma Jean, because yeah. I had no idea. I didn't really know who Marilyn Monroe was, much other than a couple posters that you'd see up in Hollywood.
Yeah,
but yeah, this song was quite a tribute to her, and so sad.
Yeah,
and that great line. Even when you died, the press still hounded you. All the papers had to say that Marilyn was found in the nude. I mean, just brilliant.
Yeah. And so like on the nose for or not on the nose, just so like a perfect representation of that whole industry and that whole experience, you know, like just the soulless like paparazzi of it all, you know?
Yeah. It's just bottom feeders that, sometimes, you know, that tended to, I don't, it's gotten better, but really abused these women in ways.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely. Definitely.
It's kind of sickening, but
yeah. Yeah. No, that's always like, you know, something on these episodes we, you know, we run into a lot, you know, that times, you know, were different.
Rock, you can't change rock history.
History. But yeah. Yeah. But like you know, we run into these things that are just so, reflections of awful times. It's to me too, this is insane that this is the second track, like this beautiful, like, I don't know if Requiem's the right word, but beautiful, you know, song.
There's a very nice motion to the album as well, because it's like, it goes right from like death, you know, a funeral into a beautiful remembrance song about somebody.
That's
true.
And
that's very, it's very cool.
Yeah, I was going to say, A Funeral for a Friend went right into Candle in the Wind. Yeah. Thematically, it would make sense. But like Love Lies Bleeding's right between them, which is like a friggin' epic rock, whatever, you know.
And you're coming out of this long track that's got so much energy in it. So it's kind of okay to already tone it down, because you practically have done three songs already, four songs, the length of.
Yeah. That's true.
I want to just decompress a little bit, just bring it down, and then we'll come back up.
Yeah, I noticed he did that in another album, either Caribou or the one before this one. I listened to both of those today, and the second track again was very slow. But yeah, he's good at those like powerful slow ballads that like keep you hooked, that don't make you like tired and like skip, you know. And this one, I just love the line, you know, your candle burned out, long ago,
long before the legend ever
long before,
did.
Yes, the legend ever did. And the way he sings it is just like heart wrenching. You know what I mean?
Yeah. He's a genius melody writer. I don't know how involved he is in the lyrics. I'm sure he tweaks things, but
yeah,
those melodies.
Yeah, he just has a certain way with words and singing them.
I've in my research, I've seen that like Bernie really does the lyrics. Like he'll just write something and like give it to Elton, and Elton will just
like the heavy lifting.
Sit at a piano, you know, and
just kind of polish it a little bit.
Well, yeah, I there was this article in this Rolling Stone rock and roll history book thing that I have from 93 that referred to them as just like a pop rock machine. You know what I mean? Like just the two of them. You know, they were just like a factory just pumping out the hits.
Lennon McCartney, if you will.
Yeah. You know,
similar.
Well, yeah, and I love that Taupin got to like experience like the greatness of the rock star life, but without the spotlight.
That
had to be nice. That had to be nice, dude.
Elton loved that spotlight.
Well, yeah, exactly. Like he took it more than
he's
like,
"I'll take your half too, Bernie."
yeah, exactly. It was a perfect relationship, you know.
And he could always go shopping without getting recognized.
Exactly.
And didn't have to go through any of that rock star bullshit. Just
got all the money because he wrote half of it.
Never mind that guy. There's Elton John. He's like, cool, I'm on my way.
Yeah. But one thing about this song, though, famously, besides the Marilyn Monroe connection, it was used in 1997 and reworked for the death of Princess Diana. That's I think what I probably remember this song from, just because I was at the age where, like, you know, it was just all over the TV, and like, you know, my parents knew about it and were talking about it, and I'm sure that was probably the first instance of Candle in the Wind in my life. But
yes, Diana.
Yeah, that was real sad one. Yeah. When everyone was pretty terrible. Sad about that one, like that was Yeah,
crazy.
If you weren't around in the 90s, it's just
pulled that
hard
song
to
right out of the yearbook.
Yeah, right. And then it's
ready.
Is also
ready
used,
to go.
Yeah, it is the go-to for like, you know, a sad song or a funeral or a graduation, or you know, it can be used for a variety of things. And then we have another banger, of course. We just keep on going on this Yellow Brick Road. This is Benny and the Jets.
I always thought he was saying she's got electric boobs.
Yeah, I don't
quite close the word.
No, it's one of those things where it's like, I don't think I knew the whole chorus, really.
Everybody kind of had their own lyrics for
One. Definitely.
You just had to hit that.
I think I thought electric moves, probably. Electric moves. Yeah. You know?
Electric moves.
And something
that mohair suit.
It's a mohair suit. Officially.
And I thought it was something shoes, but he already said shoes. But I thought it was moves. So yeah. I think that was, again, like you said, right, John? Everyone kind of made up their own lyrics
for that one.
Yeah. Apparently, this is a song about a proto sci-fi punk band. That's the description.
Oh, Benny and the Jets. That's the name of the band.
That's the description of it. Yeah. And there is a lot of sci-fi stuff in the lyrics. Let me see if I can find them. I mean, besides the, of course, electric boots. I mean, that's really sci-fi there.
Yeah.
Let's see. Hey kids, plug into the faceless. Maybe they're blinded, but Benny makes them ageless. We shall survive, take ourselves along, where we fight our parents in the streets to find out who's right and wrong. That doesn't sound very very sci-fi.
It's more like the Warriors.
Yeah. I mean, it's loosely sci-fi. It's not like hard sci-fi, guys, but that's the description. The audience was added later, of course, for this one. Because they thought it would be funny. Or something, but
it makes it interesting to make it sound live. I think that's pretty cool.
Yeah, Did you ever like think that it was a real live audience when you heard it on the radio or when you heard it originally?
No. Not a chance.
I never did either, but like I don't know. I feel like
I was going to say too, I love that like that
it's a very canned
clapping.
Yeah.
That's in, especially you capture it well in the clip.
Yeah.
Cuz he did that. I watched the VH1 thing. He talked about he did that on purpose because he said British folk can't keep
beep.
Yeah. Shit. yeah it's great. He's razzing, he's having fun.
It's a great bar song.
I mean, this is like just, I mean, this is just
hype song.
The way that his vocal range goes with the banner, it's
it was crazy. His range was crazy. It's such a shame that it went away.
Oh, right, because he had that big surgery at one point, right? Big vocal surgery.
Yeah, well, he was starting to panic. He didn't hit the high notes on Benny one night during that tour, and there was bad press about it, and he got, you know, really made him insecure. And so he lost his confidence for hitting those super high notes again. I'm sure he still did it, but I'm sure it was on his mind.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And it probably scared the hell out of him too. So,
yeah.
It's too bad.
I tell you, though,
that's kind of how
I
feel
him,
trying to hit those notes.
I saw him
earlier
like
today.
10 years ago. He's just as good as ever. He was put on a great show.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Well, yeah, because I mean, that's an insane range. Most people are not expected to be able to hit regularly. You know what I mean? It is. No. It's hard.
He was doing a lot of other stuff.
Well, yeah, that's true. I think we talk about that more in the Captain Fantastic episode. We get into the more of that lifestyle of his
rock and roll
and where it goes, rock and roll. Speaking of rock and roll, Beneath the Jets, I don't know. This track slaps. I don't know what much else to say about it.
Bismarcky does a good cover too.
Yeah, Bismarcky is a stellar rendition of this. Yeah. Way to
pull that one out of.
I wish I had a clip right now, but I don't. Next we have the titular track of the album. This is Goodbye Yellow Brick Road.
God damn.
Yeah, really. I mean, being handed lyrics where you're going to have Hunting the Horny Back Toad. I mean, geez. And he makes it sound so cool.
Yeah.
Don't even think about
the toad. I love how he just drops his English accent every now and again. He doesn't use it like most of the time. And then like he'll just choose one word.
Pronounce it.
Yeah. To pronounce it.
Yeah, he's a trip, but it's a gorgeous song about moving on.
Yeah.
Just honeydew vocals on that, you know, just want to melt in.
Yeah.
They're gorgeous. Like silk.
It's such a hard song to like, hey, it's so good. Like if you can just like nod or like kind of tap your foot, just listen to it, like there's something wrong. Like it's just an incredible song start to finish. Like, I don't know.
Well, and the Yellow Brick Road stuff, like it meshes with the sound of the song. You know what I mean? Like when he says Beyond the Yellow Brick Road, it gets into this just real spacey, like, I mean, the only thing it's missing is maybe some sitar, you know, to make it like psychedelic, you know?
Yeah.
But like,
thank God
it just
he didn't.
Dude, I know, right? Yeah, they could have turned it into like a like straight up like Beatles, John Lennon, like psychedelic, but this is like a different, like, you know, fantasy psychedelic. That's
it was like a choose your adventure book. You pick the right adventure to.
Yeah. Exactly. You know, you
could have went wrong.
Which direction you go in the tornado? Which odds you wind
this
up?
This one
in.
Feels like it started out more as a poem than a song.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Let me pull up the lyrics here. But Yeah, this one, by the way, I just realized the other day what exactly was going on the album cover. I never actually realized that he's like walking into a painting on a wall. Yeah, I didn't realize there was a wall there.
Yeah, that's so cool.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's like, it's very, I don't know, psychedelic-ish. And also, I feel like there's in this album in general, there's a lot of like, just discussion of the Hollywood lifestyle and the glamour lifestyle.
It wasn't an Irish goodbye. He definitely made it everyone known he's leaving.
That's true. That's true. He's going into the Yellow Brick Road, into this wall, and he's not coming back. It is definitely like a poem. Like, when are you going to come down? When are you going to land? I should have stayed on the farm. I should have listened to my old man.
Yeah, it's pretty brilliant.
Yeah, this is a theme that comes up a lot with Topin about, you know, wanting to kind of settle down, go to a farm and do nothing, you know.
Yeah, it was always kind of his dream.
Yeah, I really like that he sings about that frequently, because it's something I also like. The chillness of it is really, you know, nice. We should all aspire to be as chill as Topin.
I agree.
True.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know. This is just a beautiful, beautiful song. Star writing or song writing. I don't know. What was your first time? What was your first time hearing this, like, Ron? The actual title track.
Oh, I can't quite remember. I just thought it was a gorgeous, gorgeous song. And I didn't, you know, I couldn't understand some of the lyrics in it, but it just thought, what a nice way to say, stay the fuck away from me. I'm going back to my life. My life's changed too much. Yeah. Whoever he's talking to in this thing. I don't know if it's a relationship or a friend or whatever.
It's so hard
to figure out, but.
I've kind of taken it. I mean, personally, I was thinking of it as like him talking to like Hollywood specifically,
just
because of the themes of the album. But like, it could just be. I mean,
you know, again, like this stuff was written by Taupin, you know, so this wasn't written by like these lyrics weren't written by like Elton John, you know, so what was Bernie going through at the time? That's the question we need to be
asking. Well, they have like this weird...
He's just a poet, so, you know.
Well, they have this interesting fascination with, you know, American life in general being British dudes, you know. Their like kind of take and perspective on, you know, very American things, I think, is kind of what makes it so special, I guess, to me. Because they're not kind of saddled with the history of being an American necessarily, you know. They're like, they can kind of, you know, wear it on their sleeve a little bit, and love it, you know what I mean. They absolutely love it.
Plus, once the Beatles conquered America, everybody wanted to conquer America. All the British acts.
What was I just saying before?
Yeah, yeah.
Every British rock doc. Go to America. That's where the money is.
Yeah.
Well, this next track we got for you is the fifth track. The song has no title. This song has no title.
If I was an artist who paints with his eyes, study my subject and silently cry. Cry for the darkness to come down on me, the confusion to carry on, tearing.
I actually love this song, but I think there was a much longer intro to it because they just faded up at the beginning.
It's one of the shorter ones.
Yeah, it's a weird, that's a very strange intro.
It's very weird.
Yeah, because it doesn't quite, like, I think what they're going for is like, you're like walking up to them and they're already playing the song or something. Like, you're walking into
a room
bar or something, but like, it just doesn't, it doesn't feel like that necessarily, you know. It just feels like a fade up.
Sure, you know? Sure. Yeah, it's interesting. But it's a cool song. And it's a great title. Yeah, it's this song has no title. It's brilliant.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. It's a paradoxical.
Don't know what you get when you go into it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and it's a paradoxical title because it's a title that says it's not a title. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. I like stuff like that. Like, what's that song? You're so vain. You probably think the song is about you. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah.
That's a paradox. Like, no matter what.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
You know what I mean? Like she is talking about the person in question, but she's accusing them of being that it's because they're vain. But it actually is them. You know, it's anyway, similar thing with this song has no title. And I love that, you know, he loves his ragtime and his, like, you know, kind of
he does
getting into the like bar, like hopping bar stuff, you know.
You could tell he enjoyed doing that.
Yeah.
He did that stuff in his youth.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Just tickling the ivories, you know.
I think the next song does a pretty good job of that.
Oh, Gray Seal. Yeah, that's right. We'll speed it up. Speaking of tickling some ivories. Well, actually, no. That's not a good transition. Seals don't have ivory.
You can still tickle the seal.
You can still tickle the seal from the great British Isles. Here is Gray Seal.
Boogie guitar.
Oh, yeah. Just keeping the boogie
this
going.
This song never made an ounce track. Of sense to me. So I there's a, like I said, there's a couple on this that
who
I never.
Gray Seal?
Who the hell is Gray Seal?
This one's just, I love the lyrics for this one because it's like, it's so out there, you know?
So.
Yeah, it's very like, it reminds me of very like Beatles-y kind of cryptic lyrics, you know? But apparently the Gray Seal is a native to the British Isles. So I don't know. It's possible that they saw them when they were young. Who knows? It's a loose connection. I like that the Gray Seal's wise and he's just, you know, he's just looking off and thinking about how cool this Gray Seal is. Wondering what's going on.
Enjoying life as always do.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's pretty amazing.
That's Gray Seal. And then this next track actually, Jamaica Jerkoff. We should actually talk about a little bit of the production right now, because like they were originally going to record this one in Jamaica, where the Rolling Stones recorded. Apparently a George Foreman fight happening at the time. There was a lot of commotion going on in town, and they just really it didn't end up working out.
Never happened.
And so they ended up
lost
recording
in
France, I believe. This song, Jamaica Jerkoff, has got to be a remnant of that
dream.
That dream of recording their entire album in Jamaica. So here's that.
It's perfect tempo too. It's such a great group.
Yeah, yeah. Do you remember? So did you, when you heard this album, did you listen to it all the way through the first time, or did you hear?
Yeah,
like, hits
I mean, I would have, and then to be honest with you, I would decide which songs later. I said, okay, that was nice, and this was one I skipped. This is one I would skip later.
Oh, really? But, interesting.
Yeah, just because. Yeah. The depth of his other stuff, like the next song coming up.
That's true. Yeah.
Is just, that's what I was into to be emotionally moved. And somehow, you know, I was a teenager and I just You're like a Jamaica jerk off. It doesn't mean anything to me.
That's true. I mean, it's kind of in the title.
I don't know. I just like, I like how fun it is. You know, really,
it is
really
fun.
It really gives you a nice feel.
It's a catchy old tune.
Yeah.
Catchy little tune.
But it doesn't
have those
fit.
Fill out the album. You know?
It doesn't fit the rest of the album.
No,
like,
it does
at all.
Not.
Like it's definitely like the one that is a little out there.
They're like, this is our favorite find. The dream's dead, but we're injecting a little of it.
And I think it would have made more sense if they were actually recording in Jamaica. You know what I mean? They
would have been a whole different thing.
But they didn't end up actually.
They just tipped the hat to George Foreman, that's all.
Yeah. They stayed for the fight, of course. They wanted to see who got the title.
It was probably Saturday night, too.
It was probably Saturday night, but we're not at Saturday night yet. We're at the movies, and this is I've Seen That Movie Too.
Brilliant song.
Yeah.
Brilliant. That opening line is what sucked me in. I can see by your eyes you must be lying. And you think I don't have a clue? Baby, you're crazy.
Ooh.
You think you can fool me? Because I've seen that movie too. I mean, that's just brilliant.
Yeah. That's poetry. That is, this is definitely one you want to read the lyrics
that's
for.
That's calling on your bullshit right there.
Yeah.
And
I've seen that movie too, mister, or whoever, you know, like,
yeah,
I know.
Yeah. Yeah.
This one's definitely about the business.
Yeah.
Well, it was for me anyways. That's what I could relate to.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, I mean, that's kind of what I was thinking earlier, like using the kind of the movie business as a like stand in for their experience in like the music industry. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah.
Cause like, yeah. This has like the same kind of, I don't know, emotional weight, I think, as Candle in the Wind.
Well, you know,
but for romance.
You know, it's like when you're that deep into any industry, you are making a certain love to it, you know, like, he is in the music industry.
Yeah.
He knows.
You're married to it. You know? Yeah. It's like being in the mafia. and it used to literally be being in the mafia at one point. But it certainly was. Yeah. There was some wild times.
Depends if you had a nice spotlight in Vegas or something. Probably.
Yeah. You had to be hooked up with Frankie, you know? But I've seen that movie too. All right, we didn't say anything wrong or anything, but I just need to interject. There's one note that I had in my notebook that I was not able to get to during the interview because we were short on time, and that is the fact that Mystery Science Theater 3000 was actually loosely inspired by the graphics in the Goodbye Yellow Brick Road album artwork. Here's a part of an article. Joel Hodgson says he got the idea for Mystery Science Theater in high school. I was listening to Elton John's album Goodbye Yellow Brick Road while working on a float, he says. There were illustrations for every song, and one was of three heads watching a Clark Gable movie. Hodgson says it occurred to him that silhouettes cracking jokes at the expense of a movie might make for a good, not to mention inexpensive, show. And that's from the journalgazette.net. Just one quick correction on what Joel said. There was two heads watching the movie, unless he's talking about the man's second head. That's all I got. Just a beautiful, just bittersweet ballad. And then we get on to Sweet Painted Lady.
Great song.
Yeah. That one's, I got that. I like the.
You could just see someone like sitting on a French street corner, just like bopping this out. little cigarette.
Yeah, it's just, it's beautiful. His production's beautiful. He brings an accordion. He has that, sounds like maybe a French horn. It's just like, it's just lazy. The whole beat's lazy. Like,
yeah, it's chill. Like, I was thinking like French, the French Quarter, New Orleans kind of area, you know,
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, yeah. Like just I don't know, maybe a more accessible version of that. Cause I know that sometimes that can be, I don't know, it can be hard for people outside of that region to understand that, you know? But yeah, you could be in a march or something, you know what I mean? This could be a celebration of sorts.
Yeah, and he's just singing it. He's way behind the beat with his vocal at points. He's just really relaxed on this one. It's just great.
That's true.
I feel like it's like 5 minutes before bar time. Like you're and the whole time you're just like so relaxed, maybe just enjoying, like, just singing one last song in the jukebox before they get the lights on. And, you know, I'm like,
Well, and this is about a sailor. This is another sailor song. We've done a lot of sailor songs over the podcast. And you know, this is your typical, like, you know, sailor comes in from the harbor and finds a woman of the night, sweet painted lady, and, you know, time, song as old as time in rock and roll, you know what I mean? And to what you were saying, like, yeah, it feels like, yeah, at the end of the night, he's like, oh, lady, what's going on, you know? Like, so let's get down to some debauchery. Taupin and Elton John love to talk about debauchery in their songs. I've found
yes, they do.
They do.
Yeah, yeah. Speaking of debauchery, we have the Ballad of Danny Bailey, 1909 through 1934.
Yeah, great, like, song
that bass line, bing, bing.
If you really focus on the bass in most of these songs, it's like incredibly busy at parts, but it's so appropriate, so it's just brilliant bass playing.
Yeah, I haven't really listened too hard for the bass. I'll have to do that like next listen through, because sometimes that's like the third or fourth listen through is like, oh, what's the bass doing back there?
Yeah, you start picking it apart, and it's a very difficult thing to do because you're competing with his left hand on the piano, so you don't want to...
Yeah, that's true. That's true. There's a lot of...
You don't want to get in the king's way.
I mean, they're all... Yeah. And they're all very talented.
Oh, yeah. Amazing.
Yeah, yeah. The Ballad of Danny Bailey is pretty typical, kind of Bonnie and Clyde, Dillinger situation, you know, criminal.
Totally.
Criminal
typical
going 25 down.
Year old.
Typical 25 year old going down in a rain of bullets from the corrupt police department.
Just like
the Bobbies, if you
like
will.
A, you know, because
Pinkertons. Pinkertons
depends
maybe?
The crime.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I don't know.
Pinkertons. Yeah, they were the guards. They were guarding the money for Wells Fargo and whatnot shipments.
Yeah. Yeah, and apparently if you get magic cards that are
send them
ahead of
too.
Time, you will get the Pinkertons at your house. Warning to all your magic players out there. There was a recent sighting of the Pinkertons, is what I'm saying, Ron. It's actually crazy. So they this is, you know, poor Danny Bailey, you know, got gunned down. This kind of reminds me a little bit of the Beatles, Rocky.
Yes,
Rocket Raccoon. Yeah.
He went into his
room. And because, you know, another tragic story of a hero. You know.
Yep. I'm
and
with
then
you.
We have this next track is really a kind of joke track of sorts. This is "Dirty Little Girl." And the joke being that he's not talking about them dirty in a sexual way. He's talking about them dirty in an actual, they're
filthy.
They're filthy and they need to take a bath. is pretty much what he said. And it's a fun track. It's because it slowly builds to that too. Like if you're reading the lyrics, like it's not obvious at first. He's literally talking about like you need a bath, you know,
clean yourself.
Yeah, it's very funny.
Yeah. That's something that not all rock artists do, you know, add a little humor here and there. And I always appreciate it.
Yeah, you couldn't get away with it these days, you know. All hell would come rain down on you.
Yeah. No, you should. We should get someone to try cover this make a updated version of Dirty Little Girl.
Get their ass kicked publicly.
Yeah. But very, very funny song. And then speaking of Dirty Little Girl, we have an actual song about that. This is All the Girls Love Alice. Oh, I love that.
Just brings it down.
Yeah.
I mean, nobody was writing about girl-on-girl love back then. So this song was a real, real cutting edge.
Yeah. It really is. Like, it's got such a like interesting like discordant tone going on with the chords and everything. Because like there's the kind of also the undertone that like this girl that is sleeping with all these wives and things is in danger because of what she's doing as well, you know, like she's potentially, you know, putting herself in physical harm's way being this person, you know.
Yeah, and I mean that they're clear when they have getting your kicks in another girl's bed, and it was only last Tuesday when they found you on the subway dead. So she obviously dies. This probably came from a news article. I bet you. I bet there was a story, a
clipping,
news
story. And they wrote a song around. Uh-huh.
Yeah, and he just it probably affected him, and he wrote a song about it.
Yeah, that happens a lot. When you see songwriters will see something so tragic and so insane that they need to like work it out. That's part of where the sinisterness I think is in that, in the sound of that track. But it doesn't stay sinister for long. We have next Your Sister Can't Twist But She Can Rock and Roll. I just want to show how smooth that transition is.
How in the world you get from something like Candle in the Wind to this is beyond my comprehension.
Dude, he gives you everything.
Just a couple steps.
In this album. Like,
it's a bop.
He's just flying on this one.
Yeah, right? It's so fast. It's so fast. Like I'm gonna be honest. Like earlier, I forget which track it was, but like I thought for a second when the clip started playing, like did I speed this up? Like because it is so fast for the style of music that it is.
In my mind, all it seems like Jerry Lee Lewis like standing up and kicking the stool away and just going batshit crazy.
That's that kind of like, especially in the next intensity. Song. That's just that kind of
And it's got all the 12 bar blues stuff. Like it's like
just they love bar music. They love country. Love cowboys.
Yeah, and he captures that classic rock and roll, and then adds like another
couple steps.
Yeah, a couple added degrees. It's great.
This song just always feels like a classic Elton John. You know, it feels like the performance.
Well, also, it's not like one of the main single songs either. So, like, you know, it's like, you know, when you hear it, it's like, oh, yeah, this one's nice.
Great to play on Saturday night at the bar.
Yeah, that's
for sure a standout on the album.
Saturday night is all right for fighting.
Yeah, for fighting.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. You want to fight?
They were British. They were British. You know, they were always bar brawls.
A bunch of hooligans.
Yeah. So we will tarry no further. This next track is another giant mega hit for Elton John. This is Saturday Night's All Right for Fighting.
Statistically,
love this track.
All
right.
Yeah. This is, yeah. What were you saying, Dave?
I said statistically the best night.
Yes, that's true. That's true. And statistically, this is like the best decade for that night. This is, I mean, everyone was just going nuts for Saturday.
Going to the disco
dancing,
on Saturday.
Fighting.
Dancing, fighting.
Playing a piano.
Piano. You name it. Skating,
hula hooping,
just a great song.
Honky tonking,
jam,
great
use of piano.
Yeah, let that.
He is jamming on this. He is flying. I love this track.
Yeah,
how can you not like somewhere? A couple of the sounds that I really like are the sound of a switchblade and a motorbike. Really, that's so badass.
Wait, there's a switchblade in there?
It's still badass.
Oh man, I'm gonna have to listen for that. I didn't notice there was a switchblade somewhere in there. That's great.
That's in the last or nearly last verse before I think the last chorus. Yeah.
Oh man, that's great.
It could have been a switchblade comb too. So.
Oh, right. We don't know. It's just
those
the sound.
Are pretty badass.
It's just the sound. So we have no idea. But yeah, this is just such a really, really huge mega hit. I mean,
full of energy and at 11.
I'm wondering, is this by the time in 73, is like Saturday night being like a thing starting to take off by now? Is this something everyone's starting to sing about? Like, when did Saturday become a song item?
I guess it's the only time you can get hammered and sleep in on Saturday. Yeah.
Listen, it's part of the great advent of the weekend.
That's true. That's
all
true.
Of a sudden, a large portion of industrialized workers worked Monday through Friday, whatever to whatever, and then they had Saturday and Sunday off. So Saturday, you went out and you did whatever, and then Sunday you went to church
and got forgiven for it.
Monday you went back to work.
And you asked forgiveness for your Saturday night. Yep.
Yes, every time.
That's a good point. It's a good point, John. I forgot about all that.
That is white middle man America there for like 30 years, 40 years.
Yeah, absolutely. One more thing before we move on. I want to talk crap about this Rolling Stones Illustrated History of Rock and Roll. They talk a lot of crap about Elton John in this book, in his chapter. They seem to say they say that this is a ripoff of a Rolling Stones song, and they don't mention which song that they're saying it's a ripoff of. But the writer in this book really just didn't seem to like Elton John. So, but this was 93. So whoever was writing about him in 93 was like just
not vibing,
not vibing with Elton John. No. And I don't like it. this next track.
Cool.
Is that cool,
it's
man?
A great song.
This next track we have for you is Roy Rogers. Great needs no introduction.
Just a 180 from the last song.
Yeah, right.
It's like, all right, got to cool down now. Relax.
Yeah, it's such an absolute trip.
Yeah. Oh,
great lyrics, too. Jesus.
Lovely song.
Definitely. Yeah. Just goes right into the like perfect, like horse gallop or not galloping, like trotting kind of rhythm. You know, I always imagine like a cowboy on horseback when I hear this kind of rhythm in a song. And of course, Roy Rogers, the singing cowboy, is who he's singing about here.
Yeah, it's pretty great.
Yeah.
I didn't really know who Roy Rogers was when this came out because there was Roy Rogers restaurants. I'm like, who the hell's right. Roy Rogers? Why are they singing about a restaurant? Then I learned more about it.
This is a very like emotional song about a restaurant.
Yeah. Come on.
Yeah, I know, right?
Great apps.
It is a Western.
The apps. You have to see the apps. This Roy Rogers. this one is also he mentions Roy Rogers, who has a guitar named Trigger, which is what Willie Nelson's guitar is named.
Oh, I did
after.
Not know that.
Yeah.
That's really
actually, I think it's his horse.
Oh, sorry. Oh, yes, okay. You're right. Okay. It's his horse. And then yes, Willie Nelson has a guitar named after the horse.
Roy Rogers is cowboy hero. You know.
Cowboys.
Yeah. I always thought it was weird to have a guitar named Trigger, but then like I finally read that story doing this research. I'm like, oh, okay. It's just a fun thing. But yeah.
Just a nod.
Again, Topin and them love the Western stuff. They watch a lot of American Western TV, and this is one of the songs as a result of that. This next track is Social Disease.
Just a fun song.
Yeah. Another like, kind of you feel kind of drunk in this song, you know? Kind of.
I was going to say, you really feel like this could be part of like Bourbon Street, midnight, you know? Like this kind of vibes, you know? You get that little banjo in the background.
Yep.
Just checking out the Social Disease at night.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And Social Disease apparently is a very old timey like slang for like getting an STD. They would call it a social disease because you're all social.
Well, that's kind of a fun way to look at it.
Although in this track, he's using it more as to talk about being an alcoholic and drinking, and being social in that way. And he's kind of sexualizing the alcohol in this song. Like he's like, it's like his lover in this track. But it's a fun song about alcoholism. It's not sad, it's a fun,
chipper.
Listen,
it's a fun
there are fun it. Times to everything. And there are people that look at the state we're a case for the argument.
We're in Wisconsin, so this is
alcohol's fun.
It's fun.
We
take it very, very seriously here.
We do.
Almost too seriously.
We are our own beer percentage in the world of alcohol.
Definitely. We have one more track for you guys. This is the final track of the album, and he ends it with a nice, beautiful harmony.
Say hello.
Great That's track.
Such a it, good,
it's it, yeah. Another huge hit at the very end of the album. What a great way to end a record. And I always wondered if he's pretending to sing about a person or if he's actually talking about his use of harmony in all of his tracks.
I think that's I was getting is like it was like about music or something.
Yeah, I think it's totally what he's talking about, especially when he's saying open up your heart and let your feelings flow, you're not unlucky knowing me, keeping the speed real slow. And he's just grooving on this track and doing that.
Yeah.
But the harmonies in this thing are gorgeous.
Yeah. Yeah, they are.
And I think it's a beautiful song.
Yeah. Who is in there singing with him? Let me just look at the...
I mean, it's just a great track to even, not just on an album, but I think like even like a live show, it's like, it's a, it'd be a amazing just last finale for like a concert.
Yeah.
I think you just,
oh yeah.
In the mood, the right set, it's just, it feels like a nice, like, not like a goodbye, but a nice, like, farewell, good night type feeling.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And then you can all, you know, wander off to your cars. You can shuffle off to your cars and go home after an amazing, beautiful thing has happened like that. It's always, yeah, yeah. But yeah, that would be amazing. I can only imagine experiencing that in his heyday.
Oh,
and he's still around, of course, but he's, I'm sure, very expensive to go and see. So I don't know when I'm going to be seeing him. Maybe, hey, you know, if I get a chance to catch him backstage or something, I'll get to see some Elton John. Before we get out of here, though, thanks for coming on.
Always a pleasure.
What kind of new projects do you have going on? Do you have anything to plug?
Nothing that you can talk about. I've been working on that video game called The Next World, which I think this Sunday he's going to debut the trailer.
Ooh,
it's pretty amazing, hoping it comes out this year. Time will tell. I mean, it's been a lot of delays on it.
Yeah.
And the other things I'm working on, I have to sign non-disclosure agreements, but if I get them, then I can talk about them.
Yeah. Of course. Awesome. Well, we'll have to have you back on when you can talk about them. We're always so glad to have you on, Ron Wasserman. We'll get to our own plugs after we let you go. Thank you so much for being on the podcast again.
Thank you guys.
You're such a pleasure to have on.
Yeah, I've never done this before.
Great work on the Netflix.
Yeah. Oh, and yes, especially great work on the new stuff. So
thank you so much.
Yeah. Thanks again. And then what are we listening to, guys? Well, this will be the podcast ending. That's the YouTube ending, and this is the podcast ending.
There.
John, Dave, then me. What's up? What are you listening to?
Oh, I don't know. I listened to this. I literally listened to this at Wings the other night.
Yeah, and you said you listened to some of the new Power Rangers stuff.
So yeah, I've been watching it. Yeah. You know, that's good. You know, I've been listening to some of the album.
Nice.
So we're going to go for the Hot Wings.
Yeah. It's got so many tracks.
It's got 12 tracks, and there's like, yeah.
He's saying there might be a new one coming out that will have more tracks. So, yeah.
Son
yeah.
of a gun.
Oh, yeah. We'll get Mike Sausage to do all the tracks.
we'll have to get
is that 34
like,
he
like
said?
three or four seasons worth of Hot Ones and then just space them out, you
34
know?
We just do like
four ones
tenders and chop them up in little pieces nuggets and four, but
there we go. Yeah
we can do a lot of sauces.
McDonald's
30
nuggets for one like we could do a season where we do McDonald's nuggets
the budget
everybody we do budget four episode. Episodes everybody pays for one round.
Yes
If it's 34 tracks, I mean that we have to go a little budget.
Yeah We can do it, especially if it's McDonald's.
How many hot sauces? That'd be great, John.
Yeah. Anyway, what'd you listen to, Dave?
Well, through an old friend and through our music group, I was made aware that there's a new Mars Volta album.
Oh.
And it's pop, in a sense. It's pop, but it's like Mars Volta does pop. It's really... But it's exactly what you need right now.
Okay.
And they also did another album back, but it was the acoustic version of that album. And that is even more amazing.
Oh, my God.
I've been for the last, since
Goosebumps.
At some point, Tuesday or Wednesday.
Goosebumps, Dave.
I think I've listened to you do. I think I've listened to each album probably like 8 or 9 times. I just can't. Like, it just keeps like looping like this.
I'm going to listen to that immediately, Dave.
And before... Like a day before this got brought up in my group, I was about to make a post. I'm like, God, like, what albums have you been listening to? I want to change. I'm not in like a rut, but I just want just a few things blast. Like, what should I listen to? But like the next day, like that came up. I'm like, that's what I want right now. That's exactly what I need to break up my a little different.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
I can't escape it. Those two albums back to back have been playing.
Oh my God.
Just looping back and forth. And dude, everyone out there, check it out.
I'm so excited. I had no idea. I had no idea they had a new one out. That's awesome. So what I'm going to be listening to is that album. And what I have been listening to lately was I ran to a lot of shit, September. No, no, not Earth, Wind, and Fire.
December.
Gizzard. No, 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 not King Gizzard. I mean, it's always King Gizzard, but shit. I can't remember. There's been some really good stuff that's been coming on after the Elton John albums.
Supertramp.
Supertramp. Supertramp came through. And then, yeah, that band that I can never remember the name of when I attempt to. But there, a lot of really fun stuff came out of the Elton John playlist after like the albums got done. So I really enjoyed those. And yeah, that's actually about it for what I've been listening to. Honestly, I've been listening to mostly podcasts this past couple of weeks, catching up
that's
on my
Comedy
Bang, Comedy Bang Bang, catching up on the Comedy Bang Bang, and the Raj Tapes. Bang Raj Man has a podcast, the Raj Tapes, where he's talking about various movies with his friends, and it's been good. That's everything that we've been listening to. We got to plug in the YouTube. Go to youtube.com/FlyOverStatePark. We got all sorts of stuff. And yeah, thanks for listening. We were so happy to have Ron Wasserman on. That was fucking a joy as always. And yeah, we will see you guys next week for another episode of the podcast.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
The Album Concept Hour is Brad LeBaron, Dave Gallagher, and John Aker. Special thanks to King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard for the theme music. Join the discussion on our Discord, tweet to us at Album Concept Pod, or for everything else, go to linktree.com/FlyOverStatePark. See you on Side B. This is FlyOver State Park. You are clear to land.